Good evening, how are you? Let's sing together tonight.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. When we see you, we fly straight to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away.
Yeah.
Well, as you can tell, tonight's going to be a little bit different. And we're so excited that you're here and decided to worship with us tonight. And just tonight, what we want to do is encourage you to sing. That's what this is for. It's a time for just an overflow for you to praise and to worship. Tonight, we're gonna sing a lot of hymns. If you grew up in church, you may have heard some of these songs. Some of the melodies may be a little different, like this next song. But it's easy to catch on, I promise. And so we invite you to sing. This particular song we sang a lot in the quote-unquote invitation time, that time that you responded. And what I want to encourage you to do tonight is you respond whenever, all right? It's not a special time in the service. If the Lord is working in your heart and in your life, you respond. You respond with a melody. You respond with hands raised. You respond with a life that wants to live for Him. And so we invite you to respond tonight. The fall. That's you and I. If you tarry till you are better, you will never come at all. How many of you heard it like this? Well, I've got to get this right in my life before I get right with the Lord. I've got to get this right in my life, or get this together, or stop doing this and stop doing that before I come back. You see, but the part in there that is false is that you and I can't fix it. We'll never have arrived by ourselves. If you tarry until you're better, you'll never come at all. Just sing this chorus together. I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in his arms. And in the arms of my dear Savior, oh, there are 10,000 charms. Sing this together.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name.
All my strength is in you.
sing all my peace. My gracious Redeemer.
Father, thank you for allowing us to know you, to know who you are, and to love you. We are not an easy people to love, and we thank you so much for your love for us, how you supply our needs, and how you bless us. And as we give during this time of offering, we pray that as we give back to you, Father, that would be a great blessing to help others know who you are. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for allowing us to gather tonight and praise you. And we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.
As you're being seated, we're just going to sing this song over you. Maybe a little bit different, but it's a song that I just really connected with. It's been a couple months ago as I heard it and began to really listen to the lyrics and begin to feel the tension of the lyrics, because it got me to kind of thinking. It got me to thinking because the song is basically a battle between the spirit and the flesh. And you're going to hear and you're going to see these lyrics that come up, and there's just going to be this kind of this tension. Because one line is speaking in the spirit, and then one line is our flesh speaking. And I was reminded of Romans chapter 7 when Paul, about verse 15, says that, he says, "For I do not understand the actions of my own actions." He goes on to say, "For I do not do what I want to do, but I end up doing what I hate." And all that whole chapter is just this great tension of, I'm saved, I'm alive in Christ, but yet I struggle with this, and I struggle with that. And I can't get rid of this sin. Why is that? Paul is saying that my desire is to pursue after the Lord, but yet this flesh limits me to carry that out. And in that song, in this song, you're going to hear that. You're going to hear that tension that Paul shares with us. But at the end, there's this refrain that says, "Awake, my soul. Awake, my soul." Maybe you're ridden with apathy tonight. Maybe you've been rescued, but you're apathetic about life. You're apathetic about your walk with the Lord. And maybe you don't know Jesus Christ tonight. And this would be the cry of your heart, to awake my soul.
Fickle my heart and have rules in my eyes. I struggle to find any truth in your lies. Now my heart stumbles on things I don't know. My weakness I feel I should finally show. Lend me your hand and we'll conquer them all. Lend me your heart and I'll just let you fall. Lend me your eyes, I can change what you see. But your soul you must keep totally free. Bodies we will live, in these bodies we will die, where you invest your love, you invest your life.
Okay, so that was pretty cool, wasn't it? It was. So I asked the guys who are sort of the hillbilly bunch in the last service, I said, would you guys, because when I came in this afternoon, they were practicing, and they were sort of doing this sort of bluegrassy this thing where they were just like playing, you know, like, I don't know how many of you cannot play an instrument, and like me, but you sit at the piano and think, is this the moment that without practice I can just play? And then there are people who can just do that, and it's amazing. So I asked them to do for us what they did when I walked in. So if you don't mind, I'm going to ask them to do that for you, what they did in the 5 o'clock service. Be what? Yeah. Oh, yeah. Does anybody know how to, like, hillbilly dance? So we won't handle snakes or drink poison, but I don't know, whatever you do when you hear this. So you can go ding, 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 ding. Just a normal conservative church, contemporary in nature. Well, isn't that fun? That is just, you guys bless us, and just thanks for Craig and your leadership all day today, all the way up to the fourth quarter here, and it's been great. If you have your Bibles, please open them to the book of Ephesians in the New Testament. Last week we began talking about what it meant to be peacemakers. Matthew chapter 5, Jesus says, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God." We talked about how peacemakers bring to bear on a situation something that might not otherwise be present. And I told you that this week I would talk to you about what it means to be a peacemaker in the home and to bring peace to bear on the home. And then I said we'd also talk about what it meant to bring peace to bear on the church. The problem is we're only going to get past bringing peace to bear on the home as it relates to men tonight. And that's as far as we're going to take this. Now, before we get started, and we're going to be reading a lot of scripture. So understand, I mean a lot. And I'm going to be sort of interjecting some words as we read through the scripture. So stay in the word. Keep your iPad on or your phone or your Bible open, whatever it is, and stay with us. And we'll get to some notes as we wrap some things up. But men, let me talk to you for just a minute. For those of you that are husbands and fathers, and for those of you who hope that one day you will be, and maybe even some of you who are single again who hope to be husbands again, understanding the reality of just the culture we live in. I want to talk to you and just tell you this evening is not about guilt in your life, okay? And I'm not saying this because I'm getting ready to come at you with some 2x4, some spiritual 2x4. But oftentimes, whether you're preaching to ladies or you're preaching to men about very specific gender, specific areas and roles, oftentimes we're very aware of our failures. Most of the husbands and fathers in this room are very aware of how they blow it and have blown it and don't do such a hot job as husbands. We've probably had our share of apologies or times we should have apologized, and we don't live up to a standard. And the last thing you need is some punk preacher telling you how bad you are. And that is not the direction tonight. You already know what it is to own failure in relationship to your children and how you feel about things that maybe they've had to deal with out of you and things like that. This is not about you owning guilt. That is the work of the enemy trying to drive you into despair. Tonight's about you perhaps learning something from the scriptures that you and I as husbands and fathers have one response to, and that is if we're not doing what we're supposed to do according to the scriptures, it's not to heap guilt on our lives, it's to repent, to turn around to great grace and mercy and forgiveness, and to begin a walk one step at a time in a direction of obedience. I'm not going to call you forward to a great men's revival of committing yourself to never making another mistake. That's just stupidity. And I'm also going to tell you that I hope at the end of the evening you don't say, "Dear God, I'm turning over a new rock and today I will be the man of all men." I mean, because that will end by the time you get to the door. Okay? So again, tonight is not about piling on guilt, but it is working some truth into our lives so we can understand what it means for us to be peacemakers in the home. We'll allude to what women need to do and what children are to do as well, but for the most part, we'll be sticking with the guys in the room. Let's begin in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 1, and I'll begin by telling you, oftentimes when we speak of husbands and wives and children and order in the home, so to speak, most of the time, preaching begins in chapter 5, verse 22. This is man's favorite verse. Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. Men love that verse when times aren't good. They go buy the plaque and get the t-shirt and, you know, wear whatever. But what we often do in churches is we pick out verse 22 all the way through verse 33 and we miss the overall context that leads up to that passage. And that context begins in part in chapter 5, verse 1. So we're going to be reading quite a bit. Let's pick up with verse 1. Paul says, "Be imitators of God as beloved children." And that's who you are if you're a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. Again, that is the audience tonight. If you're a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ as a man, if you're not a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, or you might use the word a Christian, I hope by the time this night's over, you'll make the decision to surrender your life to Jesus. But until that time, this is a message to men who have surrendered their life to the Lord Jesus Christ for salvation. You are beloved and you are children of God. And you're told in verse 2, to walk in love, to do your life. The course of your life should be governed by love. And this is that agape love, the kind of love that is a sacrifice of everything that I am on behalf of others. It's not just being buds or friends. It is sacrificial love. And he describes it in verse 2, as Christ loved you and I, and he gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and a sacrifice to God. Now skip down to verse 15. The first thing we've seen already is we are to walk in love. The very footsteps of our life, every place we go, every place that we frequent, it is to be, we bring love to that place. But now go to verse 15. So look carefully or pay attention to how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise. In other words, we walk in a way that we see life the way God sees life. That's wisdom, seeing things the way God sees them. Make the best use of the time, because the days are evil. But don't be foolish. Understand what the will or the desire of the Lord is. In verse 18, we oftentimes use as a verse to tell people they shouldn't drink or something like that. And quite honestly, that's not the point Paul's making. He's told us to walk in love, and now he's leading to something else. Verse 18, don't get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, or that's losing control. But be filled with the Spirit. What he's speaking about is what controls you. And what controls you and should control you is the Spirit of the Lord inside of you. So already, he's talking about walking in love. The very path of my life is in love towards others, giving my life away for others. And I'm to be controlled by the Holy Spirit that is inside of me. As a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, you're sealed by the Holy Spirit, and you are to be controlled by the Holy Spirit. Verse 19 is kind of interesting. Addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart. Now, the reason that's interesting is that sort of makes life sound like a musical, doesn't it? It sort of makes it sound like you're supposed to just go around just singing. And my wife and I always joke about musicals because I love musicals. Anybody else like musicals? Who doesn't like musicals? Okay, who thinks they're just corny? Because this is my wife's argument. She's like, who's just going to the store one day and says, this makes me want to sing? And that's her deal. But, you know, verse 19, I think, is more about how we approach our lives with a song in our heart and with peace in our heart and joy in our heart. Because, men, I'm telling you, your family's not waiting for you to come home and sing. Okay, so don't think that this is the application. We're already looking at a walk of love, a life controlled by the Spirit. But look at verse 20. Giving thanks all the time for everything, you're giving thanks to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 21, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. Now look at the context that's leading up to these verses about the home. It's a walk of love controlled by the Spirit, demonstrated by how we submit to one another and put each other first. He says right there, that you submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. So out of fear of the Lord, I am serving others. I'm putting others in front of myself. Paul says it this way. He says, treat others as more important than yourselves in the book of Romans. Defer to others, prefer others. So the overarching sort of display of your life is giving yourself away in love, controlled by the Spirit, and submitting to others in everything that you do. And now he leads, and this is what happens in most of your Bibles. Most of your modern English translations, probably between verse 21 and 22, it probably has a little title that says husbands and wives, or wives and husbands, or the family. And what that's done to us is it has caused us to put a separation in the context rather than seeing the totality of this lifestyle. So we get to verse 22. After seeing a walk of love controlled by the Spirit and submission to one another, placing others first, verse 22, he says, wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. Verse 23, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Verse 24, now as the church submits to Christ. Now why? Why does the church submit to Christ? In other words, does the church, we as the church, do we look to Jesus and go, you know what, I'm going to submit to you, but I do not want to? No. The church submits to Christ because Christ is the satisfaction of the heart of the church. We look to Christ because he has given his life for us. He has promised us abundant and meaningful life and satisfaction. We look to him as the source of our greatest joy. Now, gentlemen, especially if you're a husband or hope to be a husband and eventually a father, you need to really perk up, because the call on your life is getting ready to get very serious. As a matter of fact, let me preface it with this. All that your wife is designed, called, and gifted to be and to become is on you. Just as all the church is designed, called, and gifted to be is on Jesus. The role that you play in the life of your bride and your children is a major, major call. And it's one that you're called to emulate Christ in. See, verse 24. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. And you don't hear churches running around going, man, submitting to Jesus, what a drudgery. They submit to Jesus willingly because the church submits to the one who they know is the hope of their soul. And all of us, I've said this so many times, you could probably finish the quote. All of us submit our lives willingly to that which we believe cherishes our soul and loves us the most. And gentlemen, your wives at some point must know that you treasure them most and love them most because they are wired to surrender their life to that love. And by the way, so are you guys. Because you're wired to surrender your life and submit your life to that which you believe holds promise for the greatest reward in your life. And if you question that at all, you willingly submit to what your employer tells you to do 95% of the time. Even if it's not healthy for your family, you willingly submit to transfers and moves and assignments and long stints of time away from your family. Because you believe to submit to that holds out greater reward for you than something else. You're wired to submit to that which you believe treasures you the most. Verse 25, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. That's an interesting verse because nowhere in the Bible is a wife told to love her husband this way. Later on, the Apostle Paul will give instructions for the older women to teach the younger women to love their husbands. But the word for love is the word phileo. It's the Philadelphia, the friendship love, an intimate friendship, but not this love, this sacrificial Christ-like love. So men, begin to see that if you're going to bring peace into the home, it comes with a lifestyle marked by loving your wife as Christ loved the church. And how did he love her? He gave himself up for her that he might sanctify her. Now watch, I would even actually call it the romance of these words. Watch how Jesus treasures his bride, absolutely cares for her and nurtures her and gives his life away for her because that is to be the calling. I don't care if you're romantic or not. That has nothing to do with it. It has everything to do with you surrendering your life for the bride. It goes on to say he wants to sanctify her. I'm in verse 26. Having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so he can present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. Oh, you see, in the same way, verse 28, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. No one ever hated his flesh, but he nourished it and he cherishes it. Critical words, intimate words, to nourish and to cherish. Just as, here it is again, just as Christ does the church. Because we are members of his body. Now he gives you this instruction that's right out of Genesis chapter 2. That a man should leave his father and mother, in other words, quit being a mama's boy and daddy's little hero. Leave your mom and dad and cling or hold fast to your wife. She's your treasure. Your mom isn't your treasure anymore. Your daddy isn't your hero anymore. Your wife and your family is who you surrender for. Leave your father and mother and hold fast to your wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery, and now here's where all of this comes together. This mystery, and you're like, what mystery? Well, what he's been talking about is profound, and I'm saying that it refers to Christ and the church. In other words, when the world sees you as a husband and father, they should see an accurate presentation of how Christ loves the church by the way you love and cherish your wife and nurture your children. They should see in your actions exactly what Jesus looks like towards his church. And ladies, when they see you, they should see exactly what the church looks like in its response to Jesus. That's the picture of your marriage. I tell every couple that stands on this stage or somewhere else and we do a wedding, I tell them they are entering into a relationship that is a worshipful picture. Then it goes on to say this, verse 33, however, let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. Now, we talked about peace in the home. There's a father's role, there's a wife's role, but there's a children's role as well. Look at verse 1 of chapter 6. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. By the way, parents, don't look at your kids right now. Don't elbow them or text them, okay? And by the way, this is also an elbow and text-free area, okay? So whatever's going on between you, don't look at each other, okay? Just straight up here, okay? Just like Jay was telling you guys a week or so ago, just look straight up here, and we won't make eye contact. I'll act like you're in your underwear, and we'll just not make eye contact so no one feels singled out. Honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise that it can go well with you and that you may live long in the land. Now watch this though, verse 4. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and the instruction of the Lord. I told you we're going to read a lot of scripture. Turn to the right, skip the book of Philippians, which is right next to Ephesians, and make your way to Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3. As soon as we finish with Colossians chapter 3, I'll point out a few things that I believe are essential, and they're not the exhaustive list, but some things that I think are essential for you and I as husbands and fathers who have been charged with the role of leadership in the home, the things that are essential for us to live up to in order to bring peace into the home. But let's look at Colossians chapter 3. Let's look at verse 12. Guys, let me remind you already, don't wear guilt, okay? Some of you are learning things you've never heard. And so you just now learned it, so you can't go back and start owning guilt for things you didn't know. Some of you are wearing guilt for things you know you've done. Today's the day where you stop and repent and turn around and take one step in obedience, okay? Not perfection, you're not going to get there, but obedience. So chapter 3, verse 12. Put on then, as God's chosen ones, this is a description of you, my friend, you are holy and you are beloved. So you are to put on a compassionate heart. These are things that are to be in the home, a compassionate heart, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. These qualities that are of the Lord Jesus Christ, whom we are to model. Look at verse 13. Bearing with one another. That's a description of love. 1 Corinthians 13, love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, it forgives, it never fails. Bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against the other. Now come on, folks. If you're married, you have a complaint towards each other. There's something you still don't like. I mean, they can't squeeze the toothpaste right, or something that you still, every once in a while, you rarely go through a week that you just don't go, I don't like that. And I haven't liked it for 30 years. But you know, it's stupid, but it says if you have a complaint against each other, this is where it's amazing. Forgive each other as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. And aren't you thankful? I am. Aren't you thankful that when you were made aware today of some sin in your life, whatever it was, I know what my issues are, you know what your issues are. Even when we were singing praise and worshiping the Lord, aren't you thankful that when God brought something to your mind, you said, yes, Lord, I just confess, and you can fill in the blank. Aren't you thankful that he didn't say the following? Well, I'm going to watch you for about 21 days. And after 21 days, if you don't mess up, I'll forgive you. But for now, we're going to kind of wait a minute. Because that's typically how we forgive. Okay, I hear you because you've apologized for this before and you've asked forgiveness for this before, but I'm going to wait and see. And we're told to forgive the way Christ forgives, and he forgives immediately. And we're being told in the family, in the home, and even among each other to forgive as the Lord has forgiven, so you must also forgive. But look at verse 14. It goes back to what we talked about in Ephesians. Above all these things, put on love. We walk in love, controlled by the Spirit, submitting to one another. Put on love. This binds everything together in perfect harmony. If you're to bring peace into the home, you must walk in love. And love willingly gives away everything it has for the benefit of another. So you walk in love towards one another, and it brings harmony. Verse 15, and let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. This is what you were called to in one body. Be thankful. Verse 16, let the word of Christ dwell in you. This is dwell in you richly, and you teach and you admonish in all wisdom. Here's the musical again, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. Now look at verse 18. I read all those verses so you see the context of forgiveness and love and submission and nurture. It's not just a few verses that we like to preach during family week yanked out of a chapter. So Colossians 3 verse 18, wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, here it is, love your wives. It's that same love. Don't be harsh with them. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Verse 21, fathers, do not provoke your children. Boy, look at this stern warning. Lest they become discouraged. Now, it's a lot of scripture, and how do we boil it down to a few things you and I can do as men to begin some steps in bringing peace to our home, in leadership in our homes? And I think it really boils down to, what did Jesus do? Because we are told to do things towards our wives and our families like Jesus did. So what are some of those attributes? And I want to tell you a couple today. And I want to start by showing you one in Mark chapter 10. So I hope you'll go find this. We just finished Colossians. If you're going to find Mark chapter 10, you got to go to the left quite a bit. It's second book of the New Testament, Mark chapter 10. And let's look at this lifestyle of service that we as leaders in the home have been called to, as we have been charged with the key role of leadership. And if we're going to bring peace to bear on the home, and if we're going to look and act and behave and love like Jesus did, then let's look at one of his qualities that we are to emulate, and that is this quality of service. But let's look at it. Chapter 10, I hope you found it. Mark chapter 10, verse 42. Mark is it's one of the fastest reads, so to speak. Hope that makes some sense to you. In the New Testament, Mark is in a big fat hurry. He doesn't tell you about the birth of Jesus. He just begins immediately with the message of John the Baptist. And in fact, the word he uses perhaps most often in his book is the word immediately. He's always in a hurry until he gets to the cross. You can almost feel it when you're reading the book of Mark. It's almost like a literary slowdown, and he slowly takes you through the crucifixion and the resurrection. As a matter of fact, some people believe that Mark was written to be performed as a play. That's why it moves rapidly and then slows down at the climax of it. Anyway, it's a whole other deal. Anyway, so where are we going to go? Mark 10. All right, verse 42. So Jesus calls them all together and he says the following to them. Mark 10, 42. You know that those who are considered rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. Now, what is he saying? Well, he's drawing a distinction between how the world behaves and how followers of Jesus behave. And it'd be just like you and I saying, you know how your bosses out there behave. They have a title, they have an office, so they think they can just run over you and exercise rule and authority over your life. And that's just what you expect, so to speak, out of leadership. He says, but that's not how it's supposed to be. Now, remember, before we read verse 43, we're trying to figure out how it is that Jesus loved us and served us so we can know how to serve our wives and our families. Verse 43, but it shall not be so among you, this worldly lording leadership. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant. Quite literally, your slave. So if you want to be great in the home, and you want to love your wife the way Christ loved the church, and now we begin to see that Jesus is telling us one of the highest callings of leadership in the home is service, literally slavery to those in our homes. Listen to what he says in verse 44. And whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. Now look at verse 45, because this ties it together. Even the Son of Man, and that was the phrase or the description Jesus referred to most about himself in the New Testament when he was walking the earth. Even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. Now watch this. And to give his life as a ransom for many. So already the question that's presented to you and I as husbands and fathers is whether we are serving our families or demanding they serve us in our goals. You see, oftentimes the expectation is that our families serve our ambitions. And in return for serving our ambitions, we provide what? Any guesses? Clothing? Food? Shelter?
mean, my goodness, what else do you want from me? I'm working hard. But see, we're told to love the way Christ loved, and we're going to see here in just a minute how that meant he gave everything away and forsook his dreams, ambitions, and goals, and even his place of authority, and chose to be a slave and give his life away. The question to bear on my life and on yours, men, is not one of guilt, but one of, am I serving my wife the way Christ serves the church? Am I serving my wife in that same way that Jesus knelt at the apostles' feet and stripped himself naked except for a loincloth and washed their feet? The job of the cheapest servant. Am I serving my wife in a way that shows her the enormity of her worth? Am I serving my children in a way that shows them the wonder of what God created them to be and who he created them to be? Am I serving or demanding to be served? If you want to bring peace into the home, we're told to love and to walk in the Spirit and to submit. And that submission, if it is to look like Jesus, is demonstrated by the way we serve. But I want you now to open your Bibles again and turn to the book of Philippians. You're in the book of Mark, so you need to take a right-hand turn and go to the book of Philippians. Because if we're going to serve them to bring peace into the home and to lead the way we're to lead, and the second thing we must do is learn to sacrifice for them. Now remember the context of all this. I don't want you to get lost yet. You may already be lost, but remember the passage, wives submit to your husbands, our favorite verse. Okay, we'll start selling t-shirts or something like that. This whole idea of wives submitting to their husbands, biblically that is never to be a foreign concept if men are loving the way Christ loved the church. Because see, when you and I grasp as followers of Jesus how much Jesus loves us and his love overtakes us and his service to us and as we'll see in a minute, his sacrifice for us, we willingly submit to the lover of our souls. We willingly submit to a king and a prince who gave everything for us and serves us so that he can save us. So when the Bible speaks of a husband and wife looking like Christ in the church, when a husband is fulfilling his role of leadership in service and in sacrifice, and we will see in security in a moment, when he is loving the way Christ loves the church, God in his wisdom has created every wife to longingly submit to and to wonderfully submit to and willingly submit to that one who treasures her soul on earth. And men, remember, you're wired to do the same thing as we talked about a minute ago. But after service, let's look at this issue of sacrifice for our families, for our wives, and for our children. Philippians chapter 2, look at verse 5. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, so he was God, he did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. That literally means Jesus did not say, he went like this, I am not leaving heaven. He didn't do that. He did not say, I am not leaving the right hand of the Father. I'm staying right here. No, because he loved us. Because of his great love, he did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. Verse 7, but he made himself nothing. Now remember, men, we're talking about our lives looking like Jesus. We're talking about our call to invest and to lift up the lives of our brides and to invest in the lives of our children, and we're to love our wives the way Christ loved the church. And the demonstration of that and the evidence of that is he made himself nothing, and we are called to make ourselves nothing for their benefit. He took the form of a servant, a slave. He became in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, watch this, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Some of our wives and our children have been making great sacrifices as we have chased great career dreams. And they have served and sacrificed as we have uprooted and moved over and over or changed directions or changed dreams or chased some golden idea. And they have been relegated to tagging along and following us around as we have told them that this will be the deal, this will be the time, and this will be the last move. And we have yet once to stop and find out if we are nourishing them and cherishing them and giving our lives away and sacrificing our goals and all of our dreams, if that sacrifice means raising them up to all that God called, designed, and gifted them to be. When I stand on this stage and other places with young couples, and isn't done the bride stand on this side? Is that right? Yes. The groom, I always forget. And they go through this whole thing. Before we stand on the stage, I almost always tell them, you understand when you say I do, you're giving away all of your dreams, goals, and ambitions. It's over. You are giving away who you were and who you hope to be, all for who you will be together. We're not going to change it because I don't know what would happen, but I sometimes wish at a wedding that rather than her taking on the man's name, I wish you'd swap names sometimes. I really do. You know, the poor chick, I mean, she's got to go to the Social Security office and the driver's license place, and the man's just like, oh, tell me what you need to get it done. And he just keeps his name, and the girl, she has to change everything. And I mean, everything radically changes. Everybody has to learn to, and she's grown so used to hearing her name one way. Now she's got to take on this whole new identity, and you got a whole new last name. That's half the reason she married you, because your last name sounded good with her name. And all these different things. I just sometimes wish there was for a moment where the guy had to realize, you're different now, dude. And the role you just took on is the role of looking like Jesus. And I hope that scares the crud out of you. Because you just now took on the role of demonstrating Jesus, and you just took on the responsibility of shepherding her heart into all that God designed, called, and gifted her to be. You just took responsibility for her dreams, goals, ambitions, and her satisfaction. And when you have children, you just took on the role of demonstrating a prince and a king and a father to them in a way that shows them sacrifice and service. And the question is, are you sacrificing in a way that leads to their greatness rather than them sacrificing everything on the hope that you might be great one day? We are to lead, and we are to bring peace through service and through sacrifice. But the other thing we're to do is we are to lead out in security, in bringing security to the lives of our family. If you have the opportunity to turn to John chapter 10, we're running short on time, but let me show you in John chapter 10 how Jesus describes this. And security really has a couple of components, and I'm only going to talk about a few tonight. It's one of the components is provision, and then I'll hold out to tell you this other one. John chapter 10, listen to the way Jesus describes himself in John 10. This is the passage about him being the good shepherd. I'm just going to show you one verse, verse 11, John 10, 11. A lot of pages to turn, but I hope you'll find this verse. Maybe you can highlight it. And guys, I hope you'll take it to heart. It's pretty short. Jesus said he's the good shepherd. You and I are to model the good shepherd. And listen to what the shepherd does. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He lays down his life for the sheep so they know security. He does what it takes to provide for their life and the abundance of their life, because thieves are coming to steal and to kill and to destroy. And he has taken responsibility for their security. And oftentimes that security means provision for them. But please be very careful in how you define adequate provision in Midland, Texas. Anywhere, as a matter of fact, in America, actually. Because adequate provision takes on extremes. I mean, you know, if you don't have the latest version of the Apple iPhone, then you're probably not adequately provided for, right? Or if you don't have whatever it is you like, if you don't have this and don't have that, then you don't consider that adequate provision. But you also have to be careful, because a lot of us guys like to do that thing where we're like, well, if I had all that you have when I was your age, and oftentimes that's just you trying to lay your guilt on them because you are not treasuring them. So what you do is you lay your guilt of what you are not on your children, so they feel guilty for what they're asking for, because you feel guilty for not taking care of them spiritually and holistically. It's manipulation. So we must provide for them security and provision. But let me tell you another provision for them. And I refer back to Colossians when it talks about not discouraging your children. And it's the issue of what you provide for them in the form of words. The next time you read through the scriptures, start taking notes of all the beautiful things that Jesus says about you. all the wonderful things he describes about you and how you are his treasure. You are the apple of his eye. You are his child. You are his adopted child. He loves you and cherishes you. And now think about your role as a father, walking in love, controlled by the Spirit, in submission to one another, in leading out in service and sacrifice. And the words that you are treasuring your bride and your children with. Let me tell you a little story, and maybe you can apply this, and I hope you'll apply it. I learned this from a lady named Kathy Cook. Some of you have gotten to know Kathy Cook through some things she's done with our students recently. But I was listening to her, and she was teaching me in a seminar about the importance of words and how certain words give us life and certain words take away life. For instance, I'll give you a for instance. And some of you guys, I'll ask you to help me out here in just a minute. For some of us, men especially, if we do something at work, and the boss comes in, whoever it is that approves this project, and they say the following: "Hey, Patrick, you did a good job on that." Well, for them to say, "Patrick, you did a good job," I'd be like, "Yeah, that's right, good job." Or if they said, "You did a great job," I'd be like, "Yeah." Okay, so how many of you men, if somebody tells you you did a good job, you're like, "Cool, I did a good job." Tell me that's okay. If I told you good job, you'd be like, "Yeah, sweet." Okay, well, here's the problem. The lady you've been married to for a long time, she grew up never feeling good enough. Someone told her what she did wasn't good enough along the way. And so every night for the last 25 years, she's been cooking for you. This just happens, and don't look at each other, look at me, okay? And so she's cooking, and when you sit down, she don't even ask, but you just say, hey, whatever you call her, you know, your pet name, woman, I just want you to know that this dinner is good. Now to you, at work, when your boss said, "That's good," you were like, "Hero," everything is good. But you told your wife, "Hey, this is good." And to her, you know what good meant? Failure. And it's meant failure for 25 years. And she just takes it, because if she tried to explain it to you, you'd be like, "Well, I mean, it's good." Now, I know you kind of think that's stupid, but let me tell you what happened in my life. I heard that story, and then I heard all these different words that people hear, and it gives them life. Because there are words that give you life, and there are words that take life from you. For instance, words like fabulous, super, amazing, wonderful, outstanding. So I tested this theory. Many of you know we have seniors over at our house on Wednesday nights during the school year, and that night we had about 25 kids over at our house. So I took a little whiteboard, and I wrote all these words down: good, great, super, fabulous, wonderful, terrific, amazing, supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, all the words that could make you feel good with a spoonful of sugar. And so I wrote them down, and I went around the room. We have a little exercise we do called high-low, the high of your week, the low of your week, and this is what I told them. I said, "Now, I want you to imagine something you've just done that's what you love. It's whether it's playing an instrument, competing in a sport, doing a math project, whatever it is, and you just finished it, and you just handed it to the person in authority. I said, now, I want you to tell me the word that makes you feel most amazing and special." Oh my goodness, it was amazing. We ran around the room, I'm not exaggerating. I mean, we'd go to the guy over here. I remember looking at John right here, and I said, "So you just finished," and I knew what some of his hobbies were, and I said, "You just finished doing this," and they just said to you, "What word is gonna make you go, 'I'm the best'?" And he goes, "Good." I was like, "Really? Because good's not my word. So when we get done here tonight, do not walk up and say, 'That was a good sermon.' Okay, don't do that. Just walk, you leave. I'm gonna go out the back door, and I'll fill in the blank with my word, okay?" And so he was like, "That was good." And then they go to another one, the kid says, he goes, "Fabulous." He was like, "I need to hear fabulous." And you go around the room to a young lady, and she's like, "I need to hear wonderful or tremendous." And so you go around the whole room, and it's no longer a joke, it's serious, because what they're telling you is many of them have yet to hear the word that encourages their soul. I'll ask you a question, dads. Do you know the words that lighten up and fill up the soul of your bride? Do you know the words that when your son hears it, he walks away? Because you know how your teenage sons are. They're not going to show you they appreciate it. They're going to go away and go, "Yeah." Do you know the words that make your daughter swell with pride? I'm going to tell you something. She's been telling you the word for a long time. Every time you hear her around the house and she's like, that's fabulous. That's the word, bro. Don't be an idiot. I mean, you never hear your daughter go, that's good. I mean, you never hear your daughter with her friends going, that dress on you is good. That doesn't work, okay? So, and when your son's like, awesome. What do you think the word is, bro? Awesome, probably, okay? And listen, you might be thinking, that's stupid. Oh, really? Because here's the truth, gentlemen. You're the same way. And you long for your wife to know the words that encourage you. Your Savior knows every word. As a matter of fact, you've woken up some days and you've woken up saying, I need something to encourage me. And out of his love and his mercy and his grace, he drops it in front of you in the middle of the day in a way that makes you feel loved. And we're to love the way Christ loved. And are you looking for ways to drop those words into their lives? Now look, a bit of advice. Do not get in the car tonight and do this. All right, let's go around the car. Everybody tell me the word. Here we go. Tell me the word. Fabulous, wonderful. And all. Don't do that, okay? And then don't tell everybody. And by the way, my word is amazing, okay? Don't do that. Just act like you didn't hear a thing. And just start paying attention. And start dropping the security of these words into their lives. You will be amazed at what it means because your King, the lover of your soul and the savior of your soul drops these things into your life every day. And in love and in walking in the Spirit and in submitting our lives to one another, if you want to see the beauty of a wife who submits to the one who treasures her soul and sons and daughters who obey the one who gives them safety, you will serve and you will sacrifice and you will provide security. And part of it will be just by the way you use your words and you don't discourage. Don't wear guilt. You may need to start with some apologies. You may need to start with some confession. You wake up in the morning if the Lord allows you and you begin to pray, God, by your Holy Spirit within me, help me to love my family the way that Christ loved the church and nurture them and quickly correct myself when I don't. So there's peace in the home. You see, the peace in the home and the glory and the wonder of your bride, the glory and the wonder of your children, gentlemen, it's on you. It's on you. And that's a high calling. And it's an impossible calling. And that's why you must walk in love, filled with the Spirit, in submission to Christ, because it's dependent on you. Let's pray together. So, Father, this is a gracious word from you about how we are to live as men, fathers and husbands, and so help us to do just that. Help us to truly lead by getting under and raising up rather than getting on top and getting out in front and dragging. And all of us, every one of us in this room, as husbands and fathers, need your supply and your strength so that we can live in such a way that demonstrates love and brings peace into the home, because perhaps that's why there's not peace in the home, because we haven't lived up to our calling. And if we're to step up into the role as peacemakers, it means being more like Christ in the home. We don't have the excuse of, well, our daddies weren't this or our daddies weren't that. It's us. So help us to step up to the plate individually and be what you called and equipped us to be. For the hearts of our wives and our children and the glory of Christ. Again, with your heads bowed, let me just tell you guys especially, I've said it, this is the third time now. Don't own the guilt, but practice confession. The Lord knows your heart, what you're after. He knows the help you need and the strength you need. And just be open, honest, and real with him. Just as I talked about, God, before I go to bed tonight, help me to use the right words to nurture and to cherish, to serve, to sacrifice, to provide security for my family. To walk in love, controlled by the Spirit, with an attitude of submission that looks like Jesus. Write these scriptures down we've looked at, study them, apply them in your life, and trust that the Lord will empower you to do what he's called you to do. He hasn't called you to do something you can do. He has called you to do what only he can do through you, which will require your submission to him. I pray the Lord would bless you and he'd keep you. His face would indeed shine upon you and he would bless you. And if he allows us to wake up tomorrow morning, he would bless you as you pursue the day for his glory and his name. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Hope you have a great night and a great week. You're dismissed.